We don't need that.
Yeah.
But anyway, so the way that our interviews go is that we ask just one question and it's very open-ended. And then it's pretty much wherever we go with the interview. So there's not really a right or wrong answer or anything we have to specifically talk about. So basically the question is, and of course there'll be some questions from the viewers as well. We'll just throw those in whenever. So the question is, how are games part of your life? And it starts anywhere from I was born or before I was born to, you know, when they, it's my like, body part are replaced by robotics and, you know.
Oh, yes. That's their bright future. Yeah. Someday.
Exactly. Yeah. So you can start all the way from the beginning or where.
Okay, let's go. It's like a creational story. Yeah. how did it all begin? I got this old home. Well, it was brand new, like this fancy, glorious home computer called Spectra Video 328.
Yeah.
I think it had something like 4 kilobytes of RAM or something like that. But it also had the cassette, like the tape recorder, exactly. Like the thing.
Yeah.
So that was my first contact to games in any possible way.
And okay.
It came with a couple little games. With that, of course, really, really simple. So I got into games on that side, and I thought it was like the coolest thing ever.
Yeah.
But then again, I was like 6 or 7 years old, so like, you know, everything is
cool. So everything is cool at that.
Yeah, time. Turtles. Oh yeah, it's cool. Transformers.
Yes. Of course.
Like games. I was really into that.
Yeah.
And actually got into programming through that same computer as well.
Okay.
So I was living in a really small town nearby Turku, and there wasn't any like game shops or anything like that.
Like it now, was, yeah,
like now you can actually go out and buy games.
I know.
It wasn't possible. Yeah. I even didn't know like where to start. So, like,
yeah.
My parents didn't know where to start. I got the computer from, I think it came from my uncle or something like that.
Yeah.
But what there was this like C magazine.
Yeah, I know.
This
old
magazine, and they had this like code lists.
Exactly.
So you could send your own programs and games.
Okay.
And then you took like I think it's like from 2 to 4, maybe 5 pages of like the source code.
Yeah.
And you were typing that up.
I know. I remember.
And there was this case, like, you know, when he's trying to play the game,
it was
like, you know, yeah, there's a syntax error in line 240. Yeah. And it's like, you know,
God.
Okay, you have an option there. You can wait for 1 month for the next magazine where there is the actual fix for that.
Yeah.
But if you're under 10 years old,
you don't have patience. Or you can't afford
one. Month.
Yeah.
Month.
That's the end of your life.
Yeah, like you're probably
you're
like
old,
you know,
man.
Yeah, you're done for. But you will not. You can't make it to the end of the month, like especially without a new video game.
Exactly.
So what I did is that I started going through like old magazines that have similar looking line, and then just figuring out initially it was something like there's just a little typo of like some special character missing or something like that.
Yeah.
But eventually, like I got into like fixing the bugs in the games.
Yeah, that's great.
And then I figured out that, hey, if I move, like, just change these numbers, I get more lives, I can make myself immortal, so I can actually finish the game.
Yeah.
I can add more enemies, or even change the level layout, and that sort of thing. And, like, the funny thing is that, like, I didn't consider it as, like, making games, or modding. There was no concept of modding.
Yeah.
That came a lot later, but it was modding.
Yeah.
But in my opinion, I was just making a thing.
Because it's
not like, you know, any serious making a game or being like that. No, just like doing stuff
and it
sharing
was
them with my friends.
Yeah.
It was really fun. And anyway, going forward with that one, eventually I got this. My granddad got Amiga 2000.
Okay.
And he was building this like his like home studio for himself. Like, he really was into doing videos.
Okay.
Like, if they would have been like YouTube back then, he would be commonly like streaming all the time.
Okay.
So he was doing this really, really weird, his own documentary movies about, I don't even know, like he had
Finnish really, countryside.
Yeah, something like that. Chopping, like
bear
you know,
wrestling.
About yeah, certain tractors or like that.
Oh wow.
I don't know, like it was
that's
like,
awesome.
And he was traveling a lot, so he was only doing okay, this like this little documentary about Cuba or something like that. What? Nobody never bought them like from 11,
but they exist somewhere.
They might even exist nowadays somewhere.
You should put that online.
Yeah, I was trying to like find some of the tapes. I found some of these.
Yeah, and that's amazing.
There's a lot of these tapes that like this are this old 8mm.
Yeah.
I just have to get a projector and check out like you know what is in these films. Yeah. And anyway, he got Amiga 2000. I continued on that one.
Yeah.
And it had deluxe paint, so I got into like making graphics. And also, this machine, it had a video capture card. So you could actually attach VHS into Amiga.
Wow.
You got the images to deluxe paint, and there was different.
Holy moly.
You could make text, all kind of like image processing for the frames.
Yeah.
And then frame by frame, you could actually record to the
awesome,
next tape.
Dude.
And it was really
that's
awesome.
Advanced.
It was
I would
really
say.
Advanced. Like,
yeah, that's for that time
imagine,
period,
like, you know,
it's like.
Yeah, that's like. Crap. Well, anyway, I was growing around that. I got into like building electronics and, you know, there was a lot of resources there. And yeah, then I was just continuing that.
Okay.
And even when I was a kid, like, I knew, like, okay, video games, like, that's something I want to do. Like, when I'm big, I'm going to make real video games.
Okay.
And so it was always for me kind of like. Mostly kind of straight lines, like just making games.
How did your growing up? Did you, well, I guess, how did your parents feel about this?
Well, they wasn't really like they weren't into video games or computers or anything like that. They didn't really understand.
Yeah, but they just let you like okay.
I'm just doing my thing, just like you know.
Yeah, yeah. Not like you will die alone and never get married and like.
Well, of course, all kinds of things like you know, you won't never get paid for playing video games.
Exactly.
At Twitch now.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Exactly.
But no. It's like. It wasn't, I don't think my parents never considered it to be like a career option.
Yeah.
Well, especially like in Finland, game.
Yeah.
The whole game development culture is really new. Well, it is really new in globally. We haven't been making games
like
30, 40 years in total.
Yeah.
Yeah, so like it's really new industry. Yeah. But.
Yeah. But it's pretty big in Finland, I would say now.
Well.
For at least mobile, I would say.
It depends like what's big. Like this, of course.
Yeah. Well, what does big mean? Yeah. Exactly.
I think like in total in Scandinavia, there's somewhere around. Well, I don't know. I have like someone will check out in Wikipedia in like 2 minutes and they're like, oh, he's completely wrong.
Yeah.
But well, I heard something like.
Bjorn can check, but.
Yeah. I heard some like figures about like 7,000-8,000 people working on games in Scandinavia, which is in. Much. Well, Scandinavia plus Finland.
Oh yeah, it's nothing. Don't say it. They'll kill you. Finland is not part of Scandinavia.
Kinda, but
Nordic country.
Nordic country. Yes. One, but still. So I don't know. I don't think like 7,000 people. It's not like huge or big.
Yeah.
It's quite small. Let's see. Like I was going to Amiga. Then I got to demo scene.
Okay.
Yeah, because I started to like. I started to make these like 3D engines. So that was cool.
Yeah. On what type of hardware were you playing around with?
That was I think like that was PC 486
okay.
I think.
Yeah.
Before that, I was making these. I had this like friend of mine, who works now at Remedy in Nepal all the time. And we were kind of doing this like whole programming thing together, we started when we were kids.
Yeah.
And I remember like we had this like, he was living in Turku, I was living in Naantali, but we always met like in the city between of those.
With your computers?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We had these like really, really old laptops.
Yeah.
And we met at this bowling alley.
Okay.
At the cafe.
Okay.
We weren't really into bowling.
Yeah.
But we liked the cafe. The cafe was nice. So we were sitting there maybe 1 or 2 days a week, the whole day.
Yeah.
Like from like really early to really late.
Yeah.
And we were just coding.
That's awesome.
And we had this kind of thing, like we both were making this 2D RPG engine.
Okay.
We weren't really, like, you know, into making a game. We were just wanted to make an engine and
exactly.
tools.
Exactly.
And we weren't making it together. It was a competition.
Oh,
who has a better
wow.
one? And it was
that's
sort of like,
very
you know,
good.
Oh yeah, I have really super fast pixel by pixel scrolling
wow,
maps. And I was like,
dude.
You know, bam.
Do you think
and
that,
like, you know, 1 week after he comes there, like, check this out.
That's
like,
great, dude.
Like all the time, like.
You were trying to one up each other.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's
and then
really
we
good.
Shared our findings, like all the study and all of that.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
then we got into like making these like polygon filler routines to make like this.
Yeah,
3D
yeah.
engines. There wasn't any like these GPU cards, so it was
yeah,
all
yeah,
CPU
yeah.
software.
Yeah, yeah.
So then
yeah.
we just figuring out like at first like I started with BASIC and then there
yeah.
came like this Turbo, Pascal.
Yeah.
And assembler, of course,
yeah.
like and
yeah.
it was a long time, it was just assembler because
yeah.
you needed to have
yeah,
really fast language to do all of those things.
Yeah.
And then eventually there was a C. And I remember when I got my first C++ compiler,
okay.
it was I think it was like a Borland.
Borland.
Yeah. I was just like, okay, hey kids, look
hey, at
kids,
this.
Wanna have a compiler? I'm like, oh my God, is that's illegal copy, isn't it? I was like, you know, hey, no one can know about this one. because
other
this
than
is
the
illegal.
Internet.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
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 Yeah. Borland's
bad,
gonna come
bad,
after
bad.
You now.
Yeah,
are they still
like,
in
oh.
business now? I think that's gone.
I have no idea.
I have
what
no idea.
Doing.
What
like,
happened?
What happened to them? Yeah.
I don't remember.
But still, like, I remember thinking about it, like, oh my God, like, this
yeah,
is
it's
what
a big
the,
deal.
This is what the real programmers
I know.
Use. wow, it was so amazing.
Yeah.
yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, I for the people that don't know about assembly, like, some of the demos I've seen, like, They'll take a piece of hardware and make it do things that, like, blow your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it, one I saw it was like Atari 2600 or just some strange thing, and it was doing stuff. And I was just like, if my Atari, if there was a game that did that on my Atari 2600 when I was that age,
yeah,
I
yeah.
literally would think like, okay, this is like real life, like this is the greatest thing that has ever happened in the world. It would
yeah.
just literally, your mind could not handle like how amazing it is.
Yeah.
So it's amazing like what they can do with
yes.
hardware.
Yeah.
So.
And it is, yeah.
So
okay.
what happened from there? Did you go into school or did you just skip stuff
well,
and you're like
no.
you figured it out
I'm,
on your own?
I'm like I'm not a
academic.
Student. No,
yeah,
I'm
yeah,
not,
neither,
no.
Was I.
I dropped out like immediately.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
I also wanted, but I was doing okay as a student
yeah.
for a while. Like I was really into math, physics,
yeah.
all of that stuff.
Yeah.
But eventually, I remember like you know my teacher
yeah.
said that like I have a really bad. What was it called? Like, attitude against school. So she
yeah,
decided to drop my math number by one because of that.
By one? You mean out of five?
No, out of 10.
Oh, okay.
It was like 4 to 10.
Oh, okay,
Finland.
Okay, okay,
yeah.
okay, okay.
But still. Well,
that's
like,
a big deal still.
That was a big deal. Like,
yeah,
math was
crazy.
My thing. Like, I'm into math. Math is my thing.
Yeah.
Like, I freaking wanted a 10 from
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it was like, you know, screw this system.
Yeah,
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 yeah.
But I feel like just from what you said earlier that you kind of knew what you wanted
yeah,
from
exactly,
the beginning.
Yeah.
And this was just like, yeah, you guys are like
yeah,
slowing
like,
me down.
No,
just
I,
get
I,
out
like,
of my way.
Yeah, kind of thing, you know, I was really bored like in the whole elementary school of that stuff.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, you know, it was, I really hated that most
yeah.
of the time. It's like just like, you know, it felt like, you know, I just like wasting.
Yeah, yeah,
let's
move
let's,
forward.
Let's go,
yeah,
let's go, let's
exactly,
go
exactly.
Then I went to like the next step after that, like I call it maybe like high school or something like, well, like
yeah.
college kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I stayed for a while and I noticed, okay,
like I'm
they
a
are teaching
or?
Me things like I've
that
already
you're...
like, yeah, because by that
yeah.
Age, I already made a couple 3D engines of that.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
If it's comes from like, you know, linear.
You could have
algebra,
been teaching. Yeah, you were probably could have taught the classes
probably
there.
Probably
yeah.
not, but still.
No. Okay.
Well, still like, I was completely familiar with like matrices, quaternions,
yeah.
all of that side.
Yeah.
Like programming my like whatever the computers contain. So
yeah,
yeah it was really like I said, okay, this is not a place for me.
Yeah.
And then like Well, let's see. I had fun.
That's good.
Yeah, I actually lived my life as like a
That's great.
Young person. So yeah, that was good. I really like that. So I'm really happy that I did that because otherwise it would be such like, you know, you're staying at the school, exactly. And then now you have permission. Career.
Yeah, yeah,
no,
exactly.
No, you
were
that.
Yeah, well, you were kind of having fun and building your career while you were having fun. Yeah. That's how I see it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's great. I like that it's not what society wants for you. It's what you want for yourself. Because society is like, no, you must go. It's like a factory. Yeah. Like everybody goes.
No. Yeah, I'll teach for that. Like, you know, for me, like, you know, for a long time, I still had this like feeling like, you know, I should finish the school, like go through the university or something like that, because you have to get that paper that the state says that the government, whatever it says,
give
that,
him a job now.
Yes, like, here's the paper, you are qualified to be a person.
Yeah,
it's like, you know,
like, so
that's like, but it's like it sticks in you.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Because you're teach it's, you know, because that is how people should do
exactly.
their people thing.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of peer pressure and pressure from society. Yeah, everybody conformity. So it's very hard to be.
Yeah, letting that like
just be like, no, I'm gonna do my thing. I know what I want, and there's people like that that just they already know what they want, so they don't want to waste their time. You know, earlier you said this is a sidetrack. I don't know when did you're doing carpentry too. When did you get into that? Because the sauna thing, I think, is interesting.
Yeah, like my dad is a carpenter. Like, he started his own like this carpenter business kind of thing.
Yeah,
this one man builder army kind of thing. And at some point, I got into it. Like, let's see, I was something like. I was in the army for a while, but it was early 20s, I think.
Yeah.
Well, in that side, like, you know, there wasn't, in Turku, there wasn't really any, like, game industry jobs.
Yeah.
So I went to these, like, I was like this, like, rent a person company, and the person comes and does stuff that
for
you.
Handyman,
something like that.
Yeah.
So I work as a forklift.
Forklift.
Oh my god, that's so
I used to have a forklift license for a very short time.
I did that for like maybe a year or something, like, you know, on and off. A little bit more than that.
Yeah.
Growing light and all kind of like these normal jobs, like
side
like, you know, I went through maybe like 20 different companies of trying all kind of different, like, you know, warehouse jobs. A lot of different things.
Yeah.
Then eventually I got into carpenting, and I was doing that for a couple of years, building a lot of saunas.
Okay, that's awesome.
Renovating apartments, building houses.
And you find that...
And I love that, like, because it was different. Like, most of the time I spend like doing digital things that is like just ones and zeros, and if you inspect them in a certain way, they actually mean something.
Yeah.
But now I was doing something with my hands that does exist. And it was different. I really love that. I got into that. Like, after that, like, when I moved from carpentering to make games, actually. So I still do.
Is that, like, is that what you tell people too? Like, what did you do? I was a carpenter. Now I make games, you know.
No, I make many things. I actually even had my little like publishing company for a while.
Okay, great.
I was living in an island. There was only 90 there was 90 people there living in there.
90 people?
90 people on a little island. Wow. And I was making crossword puzzles. I had my...
Crossword puzzles?
Yes, I had this national crossword puzzle magazine.
On the island of 90 people.
No. This was in Finland.
Oh, like, in all
like
of Finland.
Yeah,
okay.
Finland.
That's awesome,
and
dude.
And I was doing like making, like designing crossword puzzles in that.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
It sounds like a fairy tale. Like, oh, so I grew up on an island of 90.
I'm not really. It's crazy. I actually moved to the island. And, like, you know, I like that because there's like nature there. Like, no one there in a hurry.
Yeah, that's
you
great.
You woke up and. Then
did
you were like, you know, maybe I should have designed a puzzle today.
Yeah.
And then you made a puzzle and eventually you get the magazine out and maybe made some money and also selling like to different magazines.
Yeah.
Different, like, you know, tabloids and all that.
Yeah,
but, you know,
that's
like, hey,
great.
I don't have a crossword. I do crosswords.
That's great. Do you feel like some of this, I always call it, I call like everything digital or analog. That's how I'm seeing it. So I see carpentry and I see it as an analog thing. So that's how I'm going to refer to it right now. And do you feel like there's an influence across that thing? Like, do you feel like?
Yes, there is. And there's a good like example on the carpenter side. Because I was into 3D modeling at that point as well. So I wanted to make like, when there was a new project, I made this like using SketchUp or something else, like 3ds Max. I made it like 3D models, like what we are going to do for the client.
Yeah.
So it was like really nice that you're designing like the apartment, what we are going to do, and then building a 3D model and doing this whole design process with the client as well. And eventually I started a company through that.
Okay.
So I had this architectural visualization company.
Okay.
I ran that for a few years, 3-4 years, I think.
How old
like
were you at that time?
At that time, these are hard questions. Maybe if I say something like 26, 27, somewhere around there.
Yeah. What was your first?
We met in 2000.
I think it was 2010. I thought either 9 or 10. So it might be 2010.
Yeah, maybe like 27. Around the time, like actually, when we met, I was running
that. That's what you were doing.
Yeah, I was running that studio.
What would you say was your first company then? Like official?
Well, like it was like this, like the company, it was this crossword puzzle thing.
Okay, okay, just check. And how old were you then?
It was just after the army, so 19. Like
that's crazy because,
19,
think about, how many people, because when I was 19, I was an idiot.
I was as well.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
But you were an idiot with a company. You were dumb enough to start a company.
Yeah, so the thing
difference.
About that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's very amazing that you were already kind of entrepreneurial minded, already like, hey, here's the thing. Hey, let's see what I can do with this. And then kind of like, now I'll stop doing that. Now I'll do this thing. Yeah. Yeah, that's really awesome. And actually, you know what? I know that you were, I know that you're doing a lot of programming and stuff, and you were in Unity for a while, actually. And I wonder, when I started in the Game Tech and Arts Lab, there was a couple of the guys there. I don't know if you were part of that group that they were building. There was one other guy, I forgot his name, but they were actually working on building some type of engine on top of
Unity. Yes, Vesa and...
What's the
Mika.
Mika. With two I's, two K.
Yeah. There were Mika.
There's so many of them. Yeah. I was like, and they were doing something there. So there was very interesting things there. But you worked in Unity for a while too.
Yeah. So after this architectural studio thing, I actually moved. Let's see, was there anything else? Oh yeah, I was doing mobile games at the same time as well.
Okay.
So I was like two things going running in there, side by side.
Okay.
I worked on mobile games and then the studio shift to make Steam games as well.
Okay, okay.
But at some point, like, I moved to work at Unity.
Okay.
And I spent a few years. At first, I was working from Turku, so we
from
set
Turku.
It up like an office with Juha. Okay. You probably know the guy.
Yeah,
Juha and me, like this like dynamic duo.
Yeah.
And I started there for like doing the 2D tools for Unity, for designing and implementing all the tool.
Yeah, yeah.
Tool sets and.
You are still there doing 2D, right?
Huh?
Is Juha still there in
Yeah. He's still continuing that.
He's the 2D guy. Okay.
Yeah, he's now the 2D guy. Yeah.
Okay.
And there's like a little bit bigger team now as well.
Yeah.
So it was like mostly just two of us, and then we got a little bit help like from other people and for doing the 2D. It was a really, really large project in a way that building the whole pipeline, and at the same time we tried to like just shoehorn all the features in a way that they don't break anything on the existing workflows.
Yeah.
And I had constantly this vision of if you build a 2D game, it should be easy.
Yeah.
Really easy. This is like the easiest thing you should do is like, you know, you want to put an image into a game. You just drag drop something in there. That's it.
Yeah.
And other one is that I didn't want to limit people for making 2D games in like it's only the X and Z, like X and Y axis.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
I want
yeah.
to have like, okay, people can make 2D, 3D hybrids and everything have to
be milled
around that. Yeah, and it was a huge job. So eventually it was like, you know, of course making just like import pipeline for changing our picture to texture, like, you know, to sprite with a certain type of meshes and cutting the meshes to be like to saving the fill rate space and all of that.
Yeah.
Then having just a simple sprite editor for like just not really making sprites, but for like cutting them and like organizing them. And then the whole everything about it, they needed to be physics side as well.
Yeah.
All the rendering side. Sorting system, like how do we maintain somehow like the actual sorting, like what is rendered first?
Yeah.
It has to fit with the, all the 3D stuff. What if somebody wants to have this 3D light maps and then sprites at the same time and all of this crazy?
That's a can of worms right there. That's
God, I remember these like different talks. Do you regret any of the design choices in the Unity?
Yeah, there's a chat question. Do you regret any of the design choices in the Unity engine? Is there anything you would have done differently if you were working from scratch? Not the programming language scratch, but from the ground up.
Yes, if we talk about the Unity engine in total, yes, a lot of things.
Yeah.
If we just talk about the 2D, not that many. I think it's
pretty solid.
Pretty solid.
Yeah.
It's not without any problems.
Yeah.
And actually made a couple of talks around the world, just traveling around.
Yeah.
There's actually a YouTube video if somebody's interested. If you go to YouTube, just enter my name and then about Unity 2D, something like that.
There's a lot of videos of you, actually.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, like
pretty popular guy.
Yeah, there's like all kind of like for the possibly sorting. It's really can be a really pain in the ass doing that, but there are like different ways to achieve that and fix it. On the 2D side, not that many. On is like Unity engine in total.
Yeah.
If I only could have the resources.
All right.
No, the funny thing is that we are now solving on my new studio. We are solving a lot of these issues that Unity have.
Okay.
Like really core and workflow issues, and we are going to release all of those tools to the public, like all the game developers, when our game also ships.
Okay. Let's talk more about your new studio.
Yeah, let's actually go forward.
Because you just came out just recently of your studio.
Yes. So like, I just moved to Helsinki like 3 months ago.
Yeah.
And we started a new studio, and that's the thing, like, you know, because it's really new, and we really haven't talked about it that much.
Yeah.
What I can say that we have a really, really kick-ass, like old school team of people. It's a small team, so like six of us right now, around six.
Right.
And then we have like the core, like it's like six people, then we have freelancers, and then we have a group of advisors and all kind of people helping us out.
Yeah.
And I think everyone have over 10 years of experience
building
games, and we have people who've been working on Remedy for a long, long time.
Okay, great.
On Quantum Break, Alan Wake, and on Redlings, Fat Hammer, Digital Chocolates,
and
so forth.
That's great. So you kind of have like a veteran team.
Really veteran team. Yeah.
That's great.
It's amazing, like how easy it is to work with those people.
Well, they've gone through all of the you know, the battles.
I always say, like, after you ship a game, it changes you. Yeah. You look things different way. Like it's a new studio, VR, AAA, really high quality, quality value.
How long have you guys been doing this secretly?
With your 3 months.
Just 3 months.
Just 3 months.
Wow. Okay. So you're just like, hey, I want you. It's like you assembled the A team. You got in like
Pretty much. Okay. And maybe going really, really fast.
Okay. Yeah.
So the game is this like action adventure. I would say like there's a lot of action, also the adventure part. And sadly, I can't talk much about it.
Yeah,
but
I understand.
At the future stream, I really want to show
that'd
the game
be
because
amazing.
It
would
is
love
amazing.
That.
Like the people who have tried it so far, they've been like, this is
the future.
No, not the future. Like, this is the best VR experience they've had. And that really is like giving me like, you know,
that's great.
A lot of boost. And I know it's like it's getting better all the time. And great. Okay, so it's been 3 months, like the company's been there.
That's
and
amazing.
We actually have really good looking demo already going in
okay,
there.
Okay, that's
so it's
great.
Not,
I'm excited.
We are also like really, really fast. But the sign of that, okay, it's a game, blah, blah, blah. But same time, like I've been doing tools for a long time.
Yeah.
Making tools for millions of people. Like, I don't know like how many actually users they are. Oh, there's a new question.
Well, we can finish up what you were saying.
Yeah, like, yeah. So no, like, I don't know how many users they are using Unity nowadays, but still like making tools for a really large group of people.
Yeah.
It's a different kind of thing you have to do.
Yeah, definitely.
So I'm continuing that in this new studio.
Yeah.
And we are making VR tools and all of that side, and also like these logic tools that you can make to game logic, like in Visual Studio, you don't really have to program everything. Animation tools, and they use like the tool set is amazing.
Okay, and you said
and
you
we
were...
are releasing that with our game. So
that's amazing, dude.
So we are making a modding support for the game. So if you want to make this your own VR co-op multiplayer game, you can easily do that without any like you know any need for actually coding stuff, and you can use Unity itself to mod our game.
Okay,
so you get like certain version of Unity.
Yeah.
And when you have the game installed, you just pinboard, okay, the game is installed in here. Yeah. And then it kind of like, it pulls out all the tools on top
of
Unity.
Okay, great.
And then whatever you can normally do with Unity, like you can add code, asset store, like stuff, like, you know, you can just throw in stuff in there. And eventually you say like publish mod, and there you have, the mod for the game.
That's great. So. And you were talking earlier about, because we brought up with when anytime you bring up VR, it's by the way, guys, when I look this way, it means Bjorn's over there. I'm looking at him too. He's not here. He's saying,
No, it's like
saying every time you the discussion of VR comes up is the whole motion sickness thing, and you were saying that it's not a problem anymore.
It's not a problem anymore. But that's something we probably should talk in like future talks about that.
Okay.
Yeah, we have a few solutions.
Yeah.
Or doing movement in VR.
Yeah.
That doesn't cause any motion sickness.
Okay. Now I'm really.
It is really cool. Like that's been like. Everyone has been like just mind blowing that it is.
Okay.
Like. It's brilliant. Like you will love it when you like.
Okay,
you know, I can't hype it. Like, but see, like you know, we can talk about. Like, oh my God, it's going to be like the best game ever made.
But you have to see it.
I can show you. Like,
exactly.
I really want to show the game.
Exactly.
And then just talk about that.
Yeah. Well, we'll do it when you're allowed to. We'll do another stream and do that. So there was another question. What kind of games does your startup make? 2D, 3D. How many games do you have in development? Also, how big is your startup team, and what roles do those individuals fill? I think you talked about some of these.
Yeah, so strictly 3D VR. Okay, let's go that one. How many games do you have in development? Right now it's just like one. It's if you're planning to do two games at the same time or development, you should probably can one of those, just stick one game. I've been on that place a little bit, multiple times at different companies. Okay, we have now in like two or three games on production. Like, like, you know, don't half ass two things, just full ass one thing.
Exactly.
So it's much better than mine.
Exactly, I agree.
Yeah. Also, how big is your startup team?
Well,
it's kind of good. Like, you know,
plus extra.
Six plus extra.
Yeah.
I actually had like, you know, is it six, like, you know, like counting people?
Yeah,
but still, like really small
but
team.
But the roles, I'm assuming there's people that are doing a lot of multi.
Yeah, so what roles do you have in each of you? Okay, so we
You're the CTO, by the way.
Yes, I'm the CTO. Mm-hmm. I'm doing all the techie stuff.
Yeah.
And looking after the pipelines and all of that stuff. And we have artists, one guy. Doing all the art, 3D stuff. Yeah. We have another programmer doing mainly just everything gameplay related, but also making tools as well.
Okay.
So I've been teaching him, like, you know, the way of tools. Like, like in a perfect world, I would only making tools.
Yeah, you enjoy that.
I enjoy that.
Yeah.
I also enjoy making games, but you should always make games through the tools.
Yeah.
Like, so I'm really good at making tools, so I'm trying to stick on the tool side. Yeah, yeah. And then the people who are really good at designing and making games, they do that. And yeah, I'm just, okay,
and here's the
you're
tools,
good at that, and you know, what kind of tools do you want? Exactly. And I'm just like hyped up, oh yeah, yeah, new tools.
Yeah.
And okay, so that's three now. Yeah. And then we have our producer slash CEO doing all of the producer things, making sure that everything works. He's contacting all the people, all the advisors we have, just like keeping the whole thing going on.
Yeah.
Keep like restrict, like he's a superb guy.
Yeah.
And then we have one what we call our head of operations, a person who handles all the money, everything when it comes to figures like, you know, documents, all of that, when you have to handle.
That's really important.
It is really important. It really has been allowing us to move really fast.
Exactly.
Yeah. Because our main product, like, and then we have a writer.
Yeah.
That's just doing the writing because we want to make a really, like, heavy story-based game that's single player.
Is that one of the Remedy guys coming from? Are you allowed to? You don't have to say anything.
I don't
either.
Want to say.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
And accidentally, it's like a couple other people, but it's like, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a musician. Okay. He's brilliant, cool. But.
So you have an in house or it's one of the.
He's helping us out, so kind of like in house,
okay,
but
good.
I can't tell who. But it's like, I would love to spill
out
the beans.
Yeah, yeah.
If we find out. Yeah. And then we are using a lot of freelancers for the audio, for the character arts, that sort of thing. Yeah. So
I was going to say one good thing that you mentioned earlier about what a lot of people forget about game development is that it's a business and there's a business side to everything, and they get excited that, hey, I don't care about that stuff. I just want to make games.
No, you have and to care about that.
You have to. Yes. And the better you can have it's handling that, the more you can spend time actually making the things you want
games
to make.
Games as business, it's a business first.
Exactly.
Games as a hobby, it's a hobby. I love making games as a hobby, but if it's something like, you know, I really get to get people their salaries paid.
Exactly.
So they can, you know,
Live in a house and eat food and not be
like,
homeless.
Yeah,
of course.
The whole thing, like, you know. So then you have to be more responsible on these things. And then you have to think about the money side. And the best is, like, get a person who knows the money, who handles money, all that. If you're trying to stretch yourself in different places. So that's the problem. Yeah. So our production team is really small.
Okay.
So it's mostly...
But they're very efficient.
Yeah. So it's like artist, gameplay programmer, and me doing tools for that.
Yeah, but if you know...
Still, yeah. We know what we're doing. We've been doing this a long time through multiple productions. So it's smooth.
Yeah. That's great. Okay. Mr. Kokkonen, I wanted to ask where you thought the state of video game dev currently was and or what engines you think have the edge and if custom is your recommendation.
The state of video game development currently
multi-tier.
He's got it's like
I want to ask
that's
one question.
Of like really broad question, but let's go with that to the engine side because it comes to that. It comes to tools.
Yeah.
So engine, the name of that is like it's changing through like the whole game development cycle from like 80s to this moment.
Mm-hmm.
Engines usually are right now more like these platforms. If you think about Unity, it isn't really an engine, it's like this huge platform for creating interactive applications.
Yeah, exactly.
Same thing with Unreal.
Yeah.
Then there are like, smaller engines like Game Maker, for example, or I haven't checked out all the small ones, but still.
There are smaller ones, Game Maker.
So they are different kind of, but.
Yeah.
Like it seems like everyone is trying to aim to this like same direction where game engines are kind of this, it's a platform that targets then multiple platforms. It's just like one layer of development for interactive content.
Yeah.
So you don't anymore make games for Android.
No,
you don't
no,
make
no.
game for iOS.
You make
you
interactive
make games
content.
For Unity, you make games
exactly.
for Unreal, you make games for that one. So
the
game engine is now the platform.
Yeah.
So that has been changed. So if you think about like differences, like let's talk with the, about the big players, yeah, the differences in them, Unity and Unreal.
Yeah.
The biggest difference is the memory management.
Okay.
On Unity, you have your C#, .NET, kind of like that side. Mm. On Unreal, you get the C++.
Yeah.
But the difference is there is the memory management.
Yeah.
And then there is slightly different tool sets built on top of that.
Mm.
So it's more like if you're doing a large scale production, if you're going to use out of the box tools, out of the box pipelines, you're probably going to have bad time because these are meant for like generic usage, like, yeah, so like, you know, all kind of like for generic games, all kind of games.
Mm.
But it doesn't matter which engine you choose, if it's Unreal or is it Unity, you have to be willing to modify those, yeah, in a lot. And always the best engine is the engine that you know.
Yeah, definitely. For me, we've been saying that everyone's
always like, you know, no, it can't be like that. But if you don't know yet any engine, just pick one.
Exactly.
Just go ahead, try out. Like, there are different kinds, so take one that fits you.
Exactly.
It's
exactly
that kind of thing. Like, I am using Unity because I know Unity really well. I know the shortcoming of it. I know the problems with Unity.
Yeah.
And I know how to go around them, and then I know the problems that I can't go around. Yeah. And then it's like, well, that's the limitation.
Yeah, exactly.
And I would love to use Unreal, but sadly, like, I don't know Unreal that well. I know it a little bit.
Hmm.
I know, like, little games with that, but when you talk about a real production, the biggest risk is that I don't know the risks of the engine.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah,
it's not perfect. And yeah, like, yeah, it's not coming like, no, you should use Unreal because it's a perfect engine, there's no problems at all. It's like, you know,
come on.
Yeah, so yeah, it doesn't work like that.
Yeah.
So
yeah, yeah,
there are problems. So, but I don't know all the problems.
Yeah.
So that's a problem.
Yeah.
About the custom engine, I always recommend doing custom engines. People are not doing enough engines nowadays and tools and all of that. If you make an engine, you will learn a lot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It makes you learn all kind of definitely different things about the, like how everything is taking care of the backside of life. And when you start really building an engine, and actually building an engine nowadays, it isn't that hard. You have to figure out the architecture, like what you're aiming to do.
Yeah.
If you use Unity or Unreal, you kind of like start to figure out, oh, it engine should have like these sort of things.
Yeah.
Then you can pretty much go to a GitHub if you want to have a render, for example, like you want to have rendering, like, you know, drawing some polygon soup somewhere. There's the, what's it called, like BGFX, something like that.
What's it called? I know, I think I know what you're talking this, about.
But I don't remember, like,
maybe you can,
I checked it out like like half a year ago. I checked out like what the situation with like open source.
Yeah.
All these things, and I took like, okay, let's take like, I took like 1 week. Okay, I will set up a new engine.
Yeah.
And eventually I had like rendering on multiple platforms. I had a WebGL compiling from C++.
Yeah.
The engine was running, the whole editor and all of that on a web page, also on Android and all of that. And I pretty much just like hooked up tons of like open source repositories together.
Yeah.
Used like I'm GUI library for doing all the UI things for building game editors, using open source component system for handling all the components in the objects, because I'm really fan of like the component based design. I love it. It's not efficient in memory wise or performance side, but it's like, you know, games are just chaos. So and it fits to the chaos really well.
Okay.
But eventually, like making engines, it's like, it's a really good, it teaches you a lot. So I always recommend doing custom engines.
Okay.
But don't ship on custom engines. Don't do that. Like, you know, if you're like, okay, let's make a game. Then you start like, okay,
let's make
2 years,
engine
let's
first
make the engine.
Yeah.
No. Like, no, you shouldn't do that.
Yeah, we've said that also many times, that you have to know what is it that you want. When someone comes in talking about making an engine, we ask them, why are you making the engine? Are you making the engine because you want to learn about making an engine and all this? Then great, do
like
it. But if it's like, I just want to make a Mario game, so is it, do you just want to go and make a 2D platformer, then go make your 2D platformer.
Yeah.
Unless you want to know how that, I mean, the engine, exactly, you know. So there has to be like a reason. What's your objective for doing
like, it? Yeah, exactly. Like, I love doing engines. Like, I think like every programmer wants to do, game programmer wants to do engines or like systems, because the system is the most glorious system. Of course you want to do that.
Yeah.
Who wouldn't?
Yeah.
Well, I think like most of the people would, but still, like the game programmer side, it's fun. But then again, like,
but
you have to get experience, like, you know, again, if you're in the demo scene.
It's what's your objective at the end of the day? If you want to ship a game as fast as possible, you know, there's probably already an engine that lets you do it very fast. But and if you want something very specific or you want to understand something else, then that's.
And if you're like, okay, Unreal is really shitty because, or Unity is really shitty because this certain feature, I will make my own engine. You will hit the same problem. And tons of even more difficult problems. Yeah, it's not like people doing those big engines, they are really brilliant.
Exactly.
They're really high-end guys.
Exactly.
And it comes to that point that we are trying to do something that we don't completely understand. We only may be making games for like 30 years doing these like generic engines. Not that long, like 20 years maybe total. And we just don't understand what a game engine should be. What kind of problems it should solve. We don't have any language of defining game logic. There's all kind of these different libraries and different languages people are still creating. But still, we are trying to
find
trying to explain computer to do something that we just came up with our mind, like, oh my god, it must be really cool if it could do this and this and this thing, and then you don't want to even handle any of the bugs. So it's a really complex problem, and and it's continuing all the time, but thinking about, like, you know, if you have a small problem with a current engine that you can get for free download from internet, you think that you're gonna fix it by making your own engine?
No. That's one thing we also have brought up a lot, is that you should still respect and admire those companies and those teams, because, you know, they have the amount of time it takes you to build this engine to do everything the way that you want it to be. And it's just you, let's say you're a one-man team. And then you have, you know, a company with tens or hundreds of people. They have an entire team dedicated to just that one portion of that engine. Like, are you going to be able to do, I'm not saying you might be amazing and you might be able to do it, but are you going to be able to make it better than that whole team that probably has come across the exact same problem, and they probably didn't implement it because there's some problem that they've realized
there's something like
together.
There is something underlying. So it's like, it's a philosophical thing. Like,
exactly.
It can never be solved. On Unity, there's a lot of those kind of things. That, you know, there are things that, you know, you just, you can't solve it. It's unsolvable. And then it's like, okay, well, this is the second
best thing.
Second best thing.
Exactly, exactly. So. Amazing beard braid. How long will you grow it? And other question, do you know how is coming along with the Unity Card of Launch project?
So about the beard, man, I should have, like, you know, easily I have a beard chivalry, like, you know. Like, my wife is a chivalry artist, like, designer. So she makes me lots of, like, really cool things, and she actually made me, like, this beard chival.
Okay,
like,
that's awesome.
Things that, you know, they're like this really Viking looking like.
That's awesome.
But beard, let's see, a little bit over a year.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think when we started, I had a beard, but
no, it's going well. We're not
This was just 2 hours ago. My beard grows way faster.
So you're like a wolf man.
Well, I mean, and I shaved earlier.
There's hardly a shirt in there.
Yeah, I have a sweater.
No, it's not a shirt.
I have a permanent sweater all the time. Okay, yeah. People think there's like a camel walking
at
the beach.
You do great in Finland.
Yeah.
You will survive through winter.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah. I don't know about beard. You should eat more. Okay, next one. Do you know how is coming along to Unity Card of Launch project? Oh, somebody has to actually, like, tell me a bit more about the Card of Launch, because I have no idea of that, whatever it is.
Maybe we should ask Yuha.
maybe.
Yeah, whatever. There's all kind of like Project XIZ and
I don't know.
Project Derp and all kind of like secret things, but
yeah, we don't know.
If it's something secret thing that I might or might not know, I probably shouldn't talk about it.
Yeah, of course, of course.
Yeah.
Well, they're gonna have to kill him now. Right when he walks out, it there'll just be this little red laser on his forehead.
Yeah, Unity's quite an evil company, but not that evil.
Yeah, not.
No, just joking. Yeah. They're great.
Yeah. Yeah, and we have a Unity, like Unity based in Finland. I don't know if people know that. Have we even talked about that ever? I don't know.
Yeah, there's a
but we have a Unity here.
Yeah, there's a big office in here. Yeah. Like,
and aren't they now in Ruoholahti or not? No.
No, last time I went there. Like they are just across the train station.
Oh, okay.
Just.
I think EA is in the train station.
I think so.
Everybody is now like around the train station. Yeah. I don't know what's going on, so they can escape really fast or something. I don't know what's going on.
I think that's like the fastest way to get to Turku. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I would pick an office for that.
You know, yeah, of course. Yeah. You know that, one hilarious thing, don't get me started on Finland finishing things, but that it starts, but there was. Like the freaking Western Metro that's been delayed. But they were talking about having a 1 hour speed train to Turku.
Oh yeah, this
I think that was like 35 years ago or something.
Yeah,
like
that. Yeah.
something. But that would be, if that was the case.
Well, now there's being like this, what's it called, the hyper...
Hyperlight drift here.
That. You just teleport to different cities. What's called now? The Elon Musk thing, this new one that super fast train kind of thingy.
Yeah,
so they like they should, let's
in California because they
have
to be careful.
Like
so people don't
be
throw
like,
up.
Like let's build that to Finland through like what? Turku, Helsinki, Tampere, this like triangle
kind
of thing. So you could get to from Turku to Helsinki in 5 minutes. So like,
I don't know. I'm still upset over the metro not being done. And
that would be like done never.
In a never, yeah. And I live in Matinkila, which is right there. And I was like, it will be done next week. And then they're like, delayed a year. But yeah. I've already seen
maybe
talks.
They're waiting for like getting powered by Olkiluoto. Yeah.
Yeah. No, you know what's going to happen is by the time it's done, they'll already have like self-driving cars in Finland anyway. So it'll just be like obsolete. It'll be like a museum that people can go through. I already saw some discussions about the train they want to create between Finland and Tallinn.
Mr. Knichi
is watching this now in VR. What's
in
up,
VR?
Dude?
Is there a Twitch VR?
Is there? I don't know.
How are you watching in VR?
TVR. Twitch VR. Maybe he's just... Dead. That's not a question!
Yeah. Stupid questions.
Yeah, yeah. He's one of our...
I want to do Twitch in VR.
That would be crazy.
We're talking about that thing. That thing. Let's not spoil anymore.
Yeah. Is there any other questions? No. Oh,
no.
We've answered all the questions. You sent us a thing. Do you want to show that?
Oh, thing. Yeah. Let's do
Bjorn,
the thing.
Bjorn can play it, and we'll talk about what we see on the screen.
And actually, you can share the link, but please share the other one I sent, like not this link.
Okay, don't show it. Don't show that.
It's fine, but you can just drop it to the chat. It's a bit.ly/Coplander. It's just like easier for people to type.
Yeah.
That's like because that's like numbers and all of kind of stuff. So it's that would be fine. If you press enter.
And then Bjorn can drive while you direct.
You're probably expert of the game already.
I don't know. But Bjorn is basically Bjorn and I split stuff. I'm the controller guy and he's the keyboard guy. So if there's a controller game, I'm the one that plays, and if it's keyboard, he's the one.
This is totally keyboard game.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, like this is like one of the things. Like I started making this prototype. I was thinking like, I want to make this Mars Lander like old game.
Yeah, yeah.
On VR.
Yeah.
And then I started like, okay, let's make it just like a really quick, dirty Unity setup. So I thought like, okay, I need some kind of engines so you can like fly around a little bit or something like that. So first thing, okay, let's do the engine code in there, like, you know, like getting the thrusters. And they were like, oh yeah, I need to bind into some buttons. So it's like a button binder. And they were like, you know, let's use Quob just because like, it's a stupid thing.
So
then I did that, and from that to the point that, okay, I could actually move, like, all of that was working. It was like 15 minutes, something like that.
Oh, wow.
So it just worked really fast. So it's like, it's just like a couple of scripts and that's all.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, this is kind of fun.
Yeah.
And then I started adding like, I added like a couple platforms there. Little plane, just like with a repeatable texture. Something like that. And if you touch the plane, then all the, like, everything just comes apart from there.
Okay.
From the ship, and then it just crashes. That's and the whole thing is just like quick iterations, quick. Then you lose, and this ended up being like quite a fun game because
the thing is that
every time you play like the next second round, you have learned just a little bit, just a little bit more. So you're learning.
Unless you're Bjorn.
He's doing really well. Looks good, man.
Great, he's doing excellent. You're doing amazing.
Yeah.
Like earlier, the second time he literally got to the platform. The third time he's like flying.
Yeah,
outside.
Like in the wrong direction. Like, but still, it's like I like this one. I noticed like, you know, when you start playing this, like I was like, you know, shit, I mean, you never make it to the platform myself. I thought, okay, I played for 2 hours of it. I was like, you know, I can't make it. And then I left away from this game for like a couple hours.
Yeah.
And when I got back to the game,
then you.
I was like, super, like, you know, way, way better. Like, at my first try, I landed the next platform.
Wow.
And that like, was something like, you know, like,
wow. Your mind was solving it.
Because, like, you kind of know, like, those structures, you know how it should move.
Exactly.
But then
you
it's like...
You make your damn
but
fingers
then you
move.
Have the Quob. It's like the most unintuitive way to do the movement for that.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, this is, like, really, like, it's, like, it's so frustrating. Like, you know, brain... You know how to do this. Like,
exactly.
Just pressing that button.
Yeah.
And so I went to like, you know, a couple hours off from the game.
Yeah.
And somehow like your brain just starts to figure out these things. Like, okay, this was probably really important. So let's take a little break now. And instead of solving. That's like that's what brain likes to do. And it's not that. And
that's great.
Eventually, I started just adding like a little bit of particles and all of that. I spent more time playing this game than actually making
it's
great. I did it in a couple of hours in total.
That's great.
And after that, it's been like being like, that's like, it's a horrible time waster.
But that's excellent. And you know, this actually brings up a really good thing that we talk about. We talk about a lot on the show is that, you said earlier the quick iterations, but the faster you can get to what you're basically, what's the core mechanic of your game, the faster you can get to it and the faster you can iterate, like find it and iterate on it, the better. Like don't worry about your menus, don't worry about special effects, don't worry about texture, don't worry about any of that stuff. Just make it so you can see what it is that you have to do. And is that unique and fun?
Yeah.
And then after you get to that, like this is a very clear thing, then you're like, now you can go in and do whatever you want.
Like, I started by doing, I want to do this VR kind of thing. And then I was like, this is fun. Okay, let's keep the fun. I was always like that. When you make a game, you start doing something. What is fun? Savor it, keep it, like, you know, protect it. What is not fun? Throw it away.
Exactly.
No, there's a multiple iterations in this one as well. I tried all kind of different things. And I was like, oh, no, this is not fun. This is not like,
exactly,
you know,
you're
not. And what is fun? That's always the question.
Exactly.
Learning. Learning's fun.
That's an excellent point.
As long as your brain has something to learn, it is fun.
Well, the brain loves challenges.
Yes.
And that's the thing. And when it doesn't get it, it's like, boring.
Boring. Let's do something else.
Exactly.
So you have to always keep like keeping it simple. Just one thing at a time.
Yeah.
Even in this one, when you actually get to that platform and you land to it, the game changes a little bit.
Oh, it does.
There is more into this.
I want to see it.
Yes.
I want to see the game change a little bit. Yes. Stop sucking.
I think there's a YouTube video of me like doing like this whole level once.
Okay.
Yeah, you can actually, when you do this whole thing,
yeah,
you get
something else.
Yeah, you get 1 point.
Okay.
And then you did another round. Then you have 2 points.
So it's like what is that game? The desert bus game.
Oh yeah.
That's basically what it is. One point.
No, then you have to go around.
So then the camera, now go backwards. Fly backwards, actually. You don't see the point. Yeah.
No, like I'm going to spoil a little bit. So when you actually land to the next platform, the camera rotates 90 degrees. So now your brain has been like, I know how this movement engines fingers, I know how they are mapped.
Yeah,
and then it changes 90 degrees, like, you know it, but it's
shifting,
like wrong way around.
Yeah.
And it's like, and your brain is having so much battle. You kind of, but not really.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's great.
So, and I've gotten really pretty good at this one. Most of the times I can actually finish the whole level.
Okay.
But
if you want to try, we can always give you, or if you just want to, or we can give the video as well.
No, I'm waiting for, like, somebody in the chat wheel.
Yeah, see if anybody, any of the viewers, see if you were able to do that too.
Yeah.
So this is now just a fun little project you did.
I was thinking, like, I really would like to add, like, some kind of a leaderboard to that to see, like, if somebody scores actually like 10 points or something like that.
Yeah,
it would be awesome to see. But nothing much, no. I'm going to take it like this. I was thinking, like, on the game that I'm actually working on this video, maybe add this one as, like an arcade game inside of the game.
That's great.
So that would be kind of cool.
Great.
And in that case, like, having, like, when you have the co-op controls like that, you have four buttons.
Yeah,
so when you have five controllers, and then you have just like four fingers.
Yeah.
And then it's like, just moving. Then you have this most unintuitive controller that you're controlling about, like, in the most unintuitive way.
Yeah.
With these VR controls. It's like, oh my God, this is just bad.
Yeah.
Because you have, like, these just two sticks that you're trying to use.
Four
fingers at the same time. Oh, it's going to be so frustrating. I'm really waiting for that.
Yeah, but this is great.
Yeah, this is like just time waster game. Now I've been thinking about, like, like this whole Twitch thing, like, if we lowered gravity a lot and smoothen out the movement and all of that, we could actually even make this, like, Twitch Plays Quadlander.
That would be crazy. Like, well, if you ever want to do that, tell us, and then we'll run it on our stream for you.
Yeah. And then eventually, like, Twitch finishing this game, scoring the 1 point.
Yeah.
Oh, it would be glorious to see that.
Yeah.
But then again, it would be really, really impossible.
Oh.
Well, then again, they said the same thing about Pokemon.
Yeah, that's what I'm gonna say. You never know.
Yeah.
I think they beat Dark Souls even.
What?
Yeah. Dark Souls? They beat Dark Souls. With Twitch beat Dark Souls as well.
Wow. Okay. I haven't beaten Dark Souls.
Yeah. But I think the way that it does is it pauses the game, right? Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So it's like pause. Okay. Now pause. Now make a decision.
Oh, okay.
So I think that's how they get through it.
Okay. Maybe I could get through it. I'm doing good. Good. Yeah.
You're almost there.
Almost.
Now you're not there at all. It's like you make these very good strides. You're like, okay, I'm there, everything's perfect, and then you lose everything.
Ooh. I've been thinking, like, I should make some sort of, like, a web page or something, like a home page. I have tons of, like, these kind of, like, these small games that are really fun and all that, but it's I'm not gonna continue with that.
So
I should just start putting these, like, online. Maybe someone else picks it up and eventually makes a fun game.
Yeah, exactly. This is actually another interesting thing that you said. Tuesday's stream? Yeah, on Tuesday's stream, again, we have a broad range of viewers, like, with different skill levels that are getting into game development. And you always come across someone that says, like, someone's going to steal my idea. I don't want to share it with anybody and so on. And I think this is actually an excellent example that, it doesn't freaking matter. Like, just if you make something,
ideas don't matter. Execution, like that.
Exactly, it's execution. Yeah. So you could put out 100 of these games, and everybody can try to copy. But at the end of the day,
you really have to have the skill to do that. Exactly. Do it right. Yeah, and if somebody has the skill in there,
then good for them.
Yeah, and you know, you probably had the idea as well. Yeah. Or if you didn't, like, you know, ideas don't matter. Like, you know, you shouldn't be overprotective about those things.
Yeah, yeah.
And also, but the thing is, like, you know, like if somebody picks this up and be like, oh my god, I really want to do a game about this one.
Yeah.
You know, well, for me, the bad case scenario is that no one will actually make a fun game out of that. The best case scenario is that somebody actually makes a fun game out of this. And I have a, like, great game to play that I didn't really have to use my time and resources to make it.
Exactly. And I think that's...
And actually, in the chat, if somebody wants, like, the source code or whatever, the project for this one, like, you know, drop a line to someone of these guys. So, like, that's possible. Like, I think it's already the repository somewhere, like, completely open.
But I think that's excellent. If you did do a page, it'd be nice if you put all these little mini games and stuff of yours. Yeah. That would be excellent.
Actually, even from this one, I made a couple of different iterations. Yeah. One, like, from here, like, I was like, okay, this is fun because it's challenging. But then I decided, okay, I will try and version, like, where you're just saying, like, in what direction that should go, and there's like actual, like, AI that is controlling all the thrusters.
Okay.
And it went, like, so cool. It was so cute, like oh, let's go right, and this whole, like, spaceship's like, okay, let me figure it out.
Exactly.
And it's like doing all these extra movements in there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And eventually, I was working with this, like, other indie guy, Juuso Mattila. I don't know if you know him.
I don't think so.
Yeah, he has even, like, he has a really epic beard.
Okay, great. Now
so,
I gotta mean it.
So we made next iteration of this whole thing, where that is an actual, like, this space tractor.
Okay.
And with, like, you know, what's it, like, a backhoe?
Yeah, a crane or a backhoe. Yeah,
like with a backhoe on the back. Okay. And then, like, four engines, and it was really cute. And you were flying through this, like, asteroids and, you know, digging stuff.
That's great.
And we didn't know where we were going with that, but it was just really, really cute.
But I really like that because, like, if you change the theme of something, you might... That's why I was saying earlier, like, find a really nice mechanic, and then, of course, thematically, you've already described what it could be. Yeah. But then suddenly, if you change the theme in your mind, you might suddenly realize a totally different thing.
Yeah, that's the thing, you know. But if you're doing something that isn't really fun, and you add graphics to that and sounds, particles, it will be better.
Yeah.
But that's the thing, it will be better. It's not necessarily going to be fun.
Exactly.
If you have something that's really simple but fun,
then
you add graphics to that, sound effects, all of that stuff, then it's a blast.
Exactly, exactly. And that's
so that's
the thing,
like, you know, graphics
thing.
And all that, it adds up, but it doesn't save it. Like, the core of it has to be, just fun.
Yeah, exactly. I totally agree. All right, Bjorn, it seems you're... But you said a Simbi got it? Okay, cool.
And Mr. Kanish.
Okay, cool. Cool. Our mods got it. That's why they're mods. So, okay, well, we got through our regular... normally, it's about an hour. We went hour almost 15, which is good. I think we can... Unless there's something else you want to talk about.
Oh my god, there's so much things.
But... I know.
But no, if there's some questions.
Yeah,
like,
if there's any more questions, we can talk.
Free to ask.
Yeah. We have about
You
another...
have a really, really cheap, like, advisor right now.
I know.
Game devs.
Yeah, take advantage. You have 15 hairs past the middle hair.
Okay. Where do you look for stakeholders and funding? Okay, so the question is, where do you look for stakeholders and funding when you're starting a new project? Also, what is your marketing strategy before a release? Generic strategy, no secrets about your current project if you have anything special. So let's start with the first question about stakeholders, funding. For stakeholders and funding, of course, there's multiple ways to do that.
Yeah, there's many ways.
Of course, something like Kickstarter and all of those crowdfunding things. That's one of the options. One is that you're going to venture capital, different smaller investors. So how do things work with investors usually is that you know someone that knows someone and so forth, and then somebody makes an introduction of you and your company to some of the investors, and you start working from there and then just meeting people. There's a lot of conferences that helps you out, like Slush, for example.
Yeah, definitely.
It's a brilliant place. So when you have a team, what they usually have is you have a deck. So just like PowerPoint, like, you know,
about the team. Yeah,
the pitch deck. Yeah,
or so one of the many names.
So you have a team. You have some kind of sort of business plan as well. Well, some sort of plan. You should have a really good business plan if you're going to.
If you're going to Slush,
you should have a really good business plan. So you really have to think about the different verticals. Yeah. Like, not only like, we are going to make a game and it's going
it'll
to
be awesome.
Awesome, and everybody's going to buy it. Like, yeah, it's probably not going to happen, really. But still, think about the different options that you have.
Yeah.
That how you generate like revenue streams.
Yeah, yeah. That's an excellent thing, by the way. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. A very excellent thing about getting money. Anytime you get money from someone, in 99% of the time, they want their money back and more money in return. And there's a time limit on that as well. So there's something that you should always remember, that as soon as you accept the first dollar or euro from someone, now it's you're even mentally or subconsciously, your mind goes, and your whole thing goes into a totally different mode.
Yeah, it is different.
Now it's time. Now we have to do this. And And you're working in a totally different way. Yeah. And that's something a lot of people forget. Yeah.
And also you are easily expected to work quite longer. If you think like, I'm going to do this little startup, it's going to be a couple of years, something like that. No, you really have to stick around for a long, long time. Yeah. So it's going to be 4-6 years, who knows.
Yeah.
But there are so many different options. But if you talk about like this normal, like this investor or VC things, that then you have to have a proper team, you have your deck, you have to go to different conferences like Slush or some of the ones where the developers actually meet the investors.
Yeah.
There are a lot of these kind of tools available.
Yeah.
And places. And then you just have to be selling yourself, selling your team.
Exactly.
It's like you can't just sit back at home doing some development computer, I'm never gonna see anyone at all. I'm just doing this thing and then hope something comes up. Yeah, that doesn't work. You really have to be really active on that side.
But
I'm not the best person to talk about like funding. I'm not like on that side. But there's a like the whole internet is full of excellent guides on like, you know, how to start your first studio and business and all that things. When you're starting a new studio, of course, like keep it small, keep it simple, and get really good people who knows their thing. And if you're building a startup, if the startup's done, like, okay, we have these 5 people who have never worked on games and let's build a startup. You're gonna have bad time.
Yeah.
So at first started working at some studio, and there's a lot of like people who are like, I'm never going to be to work in a big studio because I want to be an indie and all that stuff. No, you should like keep doing indie stuff. But if you go to a large scale production, you will learn so much. Even if it's like not something that you're in there. Like if you're like you're doing an animation or something like that. But while you're doing the animation stuff, you will learn so much about everything.
How things connect, where happens here, what that person's role is. It's really, really. That's why I was going to say working in digital chocolate helped me a lot. But then I was going to say pretty much everybody, like anytime I talk with, I worked there when I was, it's like everybody worked there or they know someone. But that was an excellent experience. And the team size was 20-25
something. Quite a small teams in
small
the company.
Teams, little pockets. But even in that size, there was just enough of people and learning the whole process and just learning like, you have Scrum and you get up in the morning, you have these discussions and how things flow and the management and when things happen. These are all very, very useful that if you just are, you know, the guy in the garage and, you know, you actually miss out on that and it could actually help you when you go back to the garage.
Yeah. Exactly. You have all the resources, all the connections. Okay, about marketing. Marketing is really complex and hard issue on games, but about our marketing, we haven't really said any guys on that. So it's like we've been working on the studio for 3 months.
Yeah,
it's a large scale production, so it's going to take a while since the, like, you know, the game is out. So marketing is something you don't plan from the first day. Of course,
there are different plans. Nice if you could, but
easily no. Yeah. And even on the production cycle, you have different target audiences. Mm. At first, when you are building a game, building a studio, is that you're easily targeting game to investors or something like that.
Yeah.
So it actually has a different design.
Exactly. Exactly.
So eventually, then you're targeting the next one, is you're targeting it to marketing.
Yeah.
To E3. So it means that the game has a slightly different design again. Yeah, because what you're trying to achieve is different. And eventually you are targeting the players while, you know, you're actually trying to sell your product.
Exactly.
It's a different design once again.
It's actually kind of interesting. You're kind of pitching and selling the dream.
Yeah.
And then you eventually get it to the reality and who it's supposed to be. Yeah. So it goes from that kind of direction, which is very interesting. Like while you were saying it, I was like, yeah, that's so true, you know. Yeah. Because you, like, the only way, how it connects to the money, I mean, you have to say the things that investors want to hear. Yes. And sometimes you might even have to implement some of the things that you might be like, I don't want that, we'll never do it. And then you'll get the investor that's like, you know, here's, you know, 5 million euros or dollars, but you gotta have this in your game or you don't get it. And then you're like, well, I guess we're, you know, we have multiplayer now or whatever it is. And then you can make a choice as a company.
Yes.
Is it
can go to that direction or you can go to different direction. Like, you know, that's the thing.
You don't have to.
But those are the things that you have to do when you are.
Yeah. It's a business.
It's a business.
You have to make a business decision.
Yeah. So making games like by yourself for fun, like, you know, things like that, the Codelander, that's a different thing.
You do that for yourself.
I'm doing that for fun.
Yeah, exactly.
But work, like when you work in games, of course there's like, it's fun as well, but also it is work. Like, it's not always fun. It's like you have crunching sometimes, like, you know, you have really hard design problems with everything. Making games is really, really hard. So it's it feels like work.
Yeah.
So that's something you never should imagine, like, when I start making games or working game studio, everything is just like
heaven.
No. They are really cute parts of the game, but eventually, like, when you ship a game, you think like, you know, there's gonna be like big parties like forever and ever. It's like more like, no, it's like, is it cheap? Is it online? It's online. It crashing? Is the servers okay? Okay, I'm gonna stay up still another 8 hours, so it's been like 32 hours now. Another 8th one.
Exactly.
After that, I'm just gonna crash. So somebody will take over because, like, I'm done. I can't
care
less.
Your party is collapsing and sleeping.
It's all the same thing. Like when you release a game, when you ship it goes online, everybody's like, you know, can we have a break now?
But
no, you can't because it's just shipped. It means that now you're starting to get all the bugs and all of that. It's like people's like, you know.
It's easy until you go like this, and then that's when it's, you know.
And easily in game production, it's like, you know, the closer to shipping date you get, it more intense everything comes. Like, everything is, like, it's, your tools are breaking, the computers are breaking because they are, like, you're stressing them to the limits.
Exactly.
And then you think about, okay, now it's online. You kind of, every time you kind of think like, okay, now everything gets easier. And it's like, you know, it doesn't.
Now suddenly it gets hit by, like, millions of players and then it's like oh there's a problem and then it's down and you're like oh my god, this is crazy.
And everybody's complaining, like, you know,
I can't believe it, this is horrible, like, you guys aren't good, you don't know what you're doing,
you're like you have no idea what you're doing. It's like, you know, well, yeah, kind of, but still like,
but we're trying.
Really hard. Okay, but there's a question still. When hiring developers, what skills or qualifications or characters do you look for? So I always look people who have shipped a game. after you have shipped a game, it really changes you a lot. Mm. So one thing is that you always have to be, you have to ship something. Mm. Not only as a game, you have to ship something. It's not like you really have to be in like this large game studio or something like that. Yeah. But no, you have to put things to other people to enjoy.
Exactly. And
when you're showing your work, is it art, design, audio, animation, video? When you show it to audience, you will get feedback, you will get better. And then when you take that as a habit, just like putting things out there,
yeah,
it will change you, like, you know, the way you work, the way you
exactly.
process all of this.
Exactly.
Other one is that what I'm looking for people is that potential. I'm not necessarily looking for like, okay, you have a long career or something, or you've been doing something a lot. No, I'm watching a potential. Like, you can tell from a person, like, when there is something like, okay, there is like this kind of like this hidden gem.
Yeah.
Like, okay, you can kind of like tell from a person, like, the person maybe has shipped some things, like showed something like to public, and then you have this feeling, okay, he's like the person, like he, she is really, really into it.
Hmm.
And you can feel like, you know, when you are, and I think it's always like, you should do what you love doing.
Hmm.
And when you do something that you really love,
you
will end up being really good at it. Because that's like something you really enjoy doing, and you always find the time and the resources to do that.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people who want to do games, but doesn't want enough to do games.
Exactly.
So like, you know, I really want to do a movie, I really want to do animation or to paint, but you don't want enough.
You don't want
to spend time with that.
Exactly.
So that's a dream. You want to have a dream, and that's fine.
Exactly.
That's brilliant.
That's great.
Just go with the dream and just like be
like,
you know, oh my god,
it's amazing.
It's like, you know, oh my god, it's gonna be brilliant. Savor it, do that, but be true to yourself. Okay, this is not something I'm really going to do, because otherwise you're just torturing yourself.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I
and
totally
making games is not for everyone.
Exactly. We always say, I've said that to my student. I teach design to like teenagers, and I always tell them that, because I scare them sometimes, and I tell them like, you know, I don't want to scare you, like definitely go. But I said that you have to love the process of making games more than you love the product. And I just said this just last night to them, that, you know, you might work in a company and, you know, you love RPG games, and now you're making a fantasy football game. And you just have, oh, I love this football player, I'm gonna have to, you know, you have to be that way, that you just love the process of doing this thing, because that's what's going to get you when you know you're in that low period and you know, crunch time or shipping or whatever, and you know, that's what's going to, you know, get you through that. And of course the love and passion and that you have, you know, it's going to push you through those really hard hard points.
And the thing is that, like, as a favorite game, something like that, making games and playing games, they are completely different things. It's a different process there.
Totally different.
The games I love to play, that I really love, I would never want to make them.
No.
I know the process way too well.
I would be,
like,
actually, I'd probably make it horribly.
I would ruin the game.
Yeah, that's like, what I'm thinking. No,
there are some games, once in a while, like, you know, oh man, I would like really wanted to love to be part of making that game.
Exactly.
And it's like, I probably would have enjoyed that. But I enjoy the game. And yeah, my problem is that more and more time passes, I notice that I enjoy more making games than playing games.
Yeah.
I don't play games much anymore.
It's
kind of really rare that I play a game. But I love making them and sharing that to people and all of that side.
Yeah.
So it's a different thing. There are similarities in both on playing game, making games. Of course, because
there's
they are
overlap
more games, but
but the
you
process
shouldn't
and
think
mental
about
is,
like, it's the same thing like making a movie, watching a movie.
Yeah.
How would you say that? It's the same thing like reading a book, writing a book.
Yeah, very, very, very,
it's a
different
very
experience,
different
mental
like,
mode,
everywhere.
Everything is different. Yeah. Yeah. Any other questions? We're done.
No,
I think we are on perfect time 1 minute.
20, 20, no. 1 minute. Okay, let's go fast. Okay.
Say something really interesting. Talk about one talent that you haven't talked about yet. Okay. That you have. Like your carpentry and whatever, but talk about something else.
Wow, a talent that I have.
Just one though.
Just one.
You put me in a really tight spot. Yeah, this is horrible. think one thing. It's like, you know, just I'm empty from inside.
That's my talent. I'm a hollow man.
Yes.
Musical instruments? Are you interested?
No, I'm completely tone deaf. Okay. That's a skill.
That is. It's very rare.
Actually, I just got a drum set, so okay. He'll be starting to play the drums.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
Yeah, that's cool. I love that. It's like it's really brutal. I was like, you know, I'm enjoying this much more than I should, and my neighbors probably hate me. But because I'm building a house, so that's fine. So the neighbors
you
are
have
far
some
away.
Distance. Yeah. But it's an actual. It's not like the electronic. It's
no,
regular.
It's like really
okay.
Yeah,
no one's sleeping.
There.
Okay, that's good. Yeah. So and have you been interested in that like for a longer period of time, or
no,
were you
never.
Just like oh, there's
no,
some drums
actually, like
or.
It was like I went home from Helsinki back to my house, and I was looking at outside like there's a drum set in my yard. Why is there a drum set in my yard? And my dad found my little brother's drum set from the garage, and it has been there maybe like 10 years, something like that. And he thought like, you know, he's just gonna drop it at my place. And I was like, well. I suppose I'm a drummer now.
You're a drummer now. There you go.
So like set it up inside, okay, and then like okay, I have no idea what this is. And even when I actually built the drum set, I built it in the wrong way.
Okay.
I have no idea about drums.
Yeah.
And eventually just going to YouTube and just thinking out like, you know, okay, this drumming stuff, okay. I have to do different things with my hands and legs, and it's really hard. Yeah. But I noticed the same thing with the quadlander, that you start doing something.
Yeah.
And you do it in like, you know, 5, 10, 15 minutes, like, you know, just banging everything.
Yeah.
And then you take a break.
Then you come
back
and you're a professional.
Half an hour's like, oh yeah, this is easy now. Exactly. And then just keep going again. Yeah.
So now you're gonna be making a VR drumming game eventually.
Well, yeah. I gotta start from like the biggest things already.
But great having you. We'll definitely have another stream in the future when you have more to show.
Yes.
And maybe we'll be in a different place streaming because we won't be able to show it here.
Yeah, here is the collection of all kind of like these weird little games, and also I have all kind
those.
Of weird little VR games already.
We would love to see those.
I hate VR in a way that it's really hard to share the content right
now.
It's like.
But in the future,
like that kind of like web player kind of thing, like WebGL, it's easy. Just take the link, play the game.
Yeah.
But on VR, when you have something small and cool going on, it is like
You're losing a lot.
Audience and people.
Yeah.
It's troublesome.
But I look forward. We both look forward. Hopefully, we have you on again.
Yeah.
And it was great having you. Hopefully you had some fun.
Smiling.
I really like the way that we are doing. Bjorn and I have actually done a lot of interviews like this in the past, not for the Game Dev channel, but for other stuff. And we really like this way, because what we've noticed is that in other interviews, like let's say you go to some, you know, professional place or whatever, I don't know, they're gonna ask you, like, we're not professionals.
No, this looks quite professional.
This is not he did this by hand.
Yeah. Well, this I had to say, like, this actually looks better on the stream.
It does. This is horrible. But
this is something.
Oh, this thing is coming off. But what the hell was I talking about?
Professional something.
Oh yeah. What happens that I've noticed in interviews is that they ask the same damn questions every time. Where do you work? What do you do? What's your position? Like, they'll ask the same thing.
Yeah.
And I never like, and the people, there's some people that I'm super interested in learning about them, and they would never know. Yeah. You go to some place, they would never know that your dad dropped off a drum set at your place, that you were a carpenter making saunas, that, you know, they don't ask those things. They just ask the same questions every time. And then after a while, you just don't listen to interviews from those people anymore because you're like, yeah, I know about that guy. He works in Unity and I did this thing.
I hate this.
And I hate
Hollywood
those.
Movie.
Yeah.
These interviews.
I don't like them. I don't like them at all. Yes. So that's why we do
the
do
actors
it this
hate
way.
That as well.
Yeah,
everybody
of course,
hates that.
Of course, like, yeah. But when you can have it like this, it's like,
yeah, we could, well, it's a nice place, actually.
And if we have a, I guarantee you, if we did another interview this way, we probably can't use the same question because now you're prepared. But when you leave it this way, we have a totally different experience and learn totally new things about you. And I think that's the, you know, the important thing. But anyway, thanks for having.
Cool stuff.
You here? Yes. And yeah, and we will continue. We will have a 10 minutes.